Welcome to the 700 Club. President Obama will have the chance to appoint his first Supreme Court justice. David Souter, a known liberal, is planning to retire after nearly two decades on the court.
His departure isn't expected to change the balance of power on the court, since the president's choice is expected to be another liberal like Souter. Here's reporter Charlene Israel.
Justice David Souter was believed to be a conservative when he was appointed to the Supreme Court in 1990 by the first president, George Bush.
He recognizes the proper role of judges in upholding the democratic choices of the people through their elected representatives with constitutional constraints.
But Souter surprised Bush and other Republicans by joining the court's more liberal wing, including voting to uphold abortion rights in Planned Parenthood versus Casey. It's unclear why Souter is stepping down from the high court, but he is known to dislike Washington and has talked about wanting to return to New Hampshire. The 69-year-old justice spoke at George Washington University back in March.
I find the workload of what I do sufficiently great that when the term of court starts, I undergo a sort of annual intellectual lobotomy. It lasts until the following summer when I sort of cram what I can into the summertime.
Souter's retirement from the bench means that President Obama will soon get to put his stamp on the Supreme Court. Many court observers expect the president to appoint a woman. Souter will likely remain on the bench until his successor is confirmed. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
I remember John Sununu was a friend of mine. He was chief of staff for President Bush number one, and we all thought that he, being a strong conservative, would put a conservative in, and we were assured that this man was absolutely wonderful, and it turned out that he got snookered and we got snookered, and it turned out the former senator from New Hampshire cackled at how he'd taken advantage of John Sununu. It was something else.
Boy, with all the things, the grilling that they put them through, how does one not know what a person's position is?
There wasn't any grilling. I mean, this guy was the stealth candidate. He never expressed himself on anything. And he just slid through, and the conservatives applauded because they thought they could trust Sununu, and lo and behold, Warren Rudman, the senator from New Hampshire, took advantage of him, and he just pulled the wool over his eyes and then laughed. Jay Sekulow of the American Center for Law and Justice is with us now from Nashville. Jay, it really won't make any difference if Souter goes down and somebody else goes in his place, will it?
Well, I'll tell you where I do think it will make a difference. Number one, Justice Souter will be replaced by somebody that's probably 50, 52 years old, so they'll be serving on the court for three decades. And I think you're going to look at, based on the judicial appointments and the nominations that have come forward and the Justice Department appointments by the president already, I think you're going to look at an appointment that will be to the left, judicial philosophy-wise, of David Souter. And I think, Pat, the key here is that the integrity of the constitutional process is maintained. And that is, you just said it. During David Souter's nomination, there really wasn't much of a hearing. The Constitution says the president has the power to nominate and appoint. The Senate's role is advice and consent. Clearly, the Democrats have a majority in that Senate, but the process needs to go forward so we understand the judicial philosophy of the nominee, and does that person understand their role as judge and that they're not a legislator. But I think the leading candidates of who you're looking at as potential Supreme Court nominee are justices far to the left in judicial philosophy. And I think one of the leading candidates probably is Sonia Sotomayor, Judge Sotomayor from the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. And, you're talking about to the left of David Souter, judicial philosophy-wise.
You know, I wonder about the Republicans. When Orrin Hatch was chairman of the Judiciary Committee, they allowed Ginsburg to just float through. It was almost like Ginsburg had something on him. But, I mean, you say, what is the deal? She is legal counselor, general counselor of the ACLU, and they blew her through on a majority
97
vote.
97-3. Yeah, 97-3. And what you've got here is there's a difference, and it's when the Democrats are not in the White House and you've got a Republican president making appointments, let's look at John Roberts and Sam Alito, the two most recent, you have a significant Democratic fight in the Judiciary Committee. You have a significant hearing with real questions, with some trepidation from some of the nominees. I mean, this is a tough process. Unfortunately, you're absolutely correct. The Republicans tend to not do that. Now, I think that may change now because this is the beginning, Pat, of the president's ability to start reshaping the judiciary in the United States. So it's not so much just a replacement of David Souter that's significant here. It's also the direction now that this court goes. True, it's one liberal vote for another, but a much younger one in all probability. But it signals where he wants to take the country. And the president could end up with three or four selections over the next 4 years.
Well, it's David Hamilton, a weird decision. He says it's okay to pray in the name of Allah, but not okay to pray in the name of Jesus. They let him go through. Well, he's not in yet, but...
But he's about to be. And let me tell you, Pat, this is the kind of judicial gerrymandering that you're starting to see from these nominees. How can you justify a Seventh Circuit Court opinion that says it is okay to pray in the name of Allah, the Magnificent, but not Jesus the Messiah? And that's exactly what the judge said, because Christianity is a majority religion. These are strict separationists to the highest degree. They are transnational in their application of international law to the United States Constitution, and they believe that it is the role of the judge to reshape the Constitution as a living document. Well, I believe the Constitution's a living document, too. It's called, there's an amendment process, and if you can get an amendment through, you can change it.
Why don't
but judges
you,
don't get to change it by the stroke of a pen, and that's what I think we're looking at coming up in the next few years.
Why don't you think the Republicans up there have got the guts to stand up against these people and really oppose them and filibuster them and do what the Democrats did?
Well, I'll tell you where I am optimistic, Pat, and I may be proven wrong on this, but I'm optimistic. With Senator Spector now going to the Democratic side, it may well be that Jeff Sessions from Alabama becomes the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee. And as you know, and he's a friend of yours as well, Jeff Sessions is a very tough lawyer, a very bright lawyer, former attorney general from Alabama. He will make it a real process on the Republican side. But I think we also have to be cognizant of the fact that the Democrats have a almost filibuster-proof majority. But I'm with you. Put them through the paces. Let's make sure the Constitution is fulfilled here.
Well, the Republican Party is in total disarray right now. They just were like wandering in the desert. This would be a chance for them to plant a flag on constitutional authority and say, this is where we're going to stand. They've got to stand somewhere.
And this should be the, you know, it was interesting because in the campaign, and you pointed this out on the 700 Club a lot during the election, no one was talking about Supreme Court justices. Now, we are 102 days into the president's administration, and he already looks like he's going to have a Supreme Court selection now. And it was not even discussed during the campaign or barely mentioned. But the president talked about the kind of justices he wanted to see appointed. It will be very different than Sam Alito and John Roberts, that much I can tell you.
Jay Sekulow with us from Nashville. Thank you. Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories. Lee?
Pat, after weeks of speculation, Chrysler has finally filed for bankruptcy, and General Motors may be headed in the same direction. This after the government pumped $25 billion into both companies. And some analysts warn the government is playing too big of a role in running these car companies. Jennifer Wishon has that story from Washington.
The nation's third largest automaker is shutting down. Chrysler will close all its plants starting Monday in hopes of emerging in 30 days a leaner company in partnership with Italian automaker Fiat. The United Auto Workers Union will own 55% of the company. The U.S. government will own 8%. Some economists say they're pleased to see a private company like Fiat being used to prop up Chrysler, but some wonder if GM will end up changing its name to Government Motors. Under a restructuring plan offered by the company this week, the automaker would turn over majority ownership to the government.
In other words, the federal government will become a 50% shareholder in General Motors. And that gets us into the N-word, nationalization. We'll have the what once was the largest car company in the world owned 50% by the American government. And that's frankly a troubling prospect.
President Obama says he's not interested in running automakers.
I would love to get the U.S. government out of the auto business as quickly as possible.
But James Gattuso, senior research fellow at the Heritage Foundation, says it would be hard for the government to unload such a large chunk of GM once the company gets back on its feet, and that the government has neither experience running a car company nor the right incentives.
Politicians don't like to cut staff, cut employment, even when it's necessary to make a better product. They aren't nimble. They don't respond to markets, they respond to votes.
Under the restructuring plan, the auto union would also get a big chunk of the company. But GM's bondholders are calling the plan unfair. They'd exchange $27 billion in bonds for 10% of the company's stock.
Bondholders may decide to take their chances in front of a judge. If they don't agree to the restructuring plan, GM will likely have to join Chrysler in bankruptcy court, a move some economists think is best.
And while auto executives and the Obama administration make tough decisions, workers sit and wait.
We don't know if we're going to have a job tomorrow, you know, let alone next year.
Some just hope workers can return to an industry that's free of the heavy hand of government. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.
You know, Pat, yeah, the government's going to own a big chunk of these car companies, but what do you think about the UAW owning 55% of Chrysler?
I tell you, it's a shocking development, frankly. I've been calling for bankruptcy for months now, since this thing began. They're finally coming around to what I said was made some sense. They've just blown about 10 or 15 more billion dollars in the process. But what is really troublesome, Lee, is the idea of the government taking this massive stake in Chrysler, I mean, in General Motors. They will not permit the necessary layoffs. They will not permit the necessary changes in product styles. They will not take any chances. They will be like bureaucrats are always. They play it safe, and they worry about the next election, and they worry about what their boss up the line is going to say about them. There will be no risk takers, no entrepreneurship. And while this is happening, the bondholders are taking it in the neck. $27 billion, and they're giving them pennies on it. And do you think any other major investor would get into any government-sponsored organization in the future? Not on your life. They need private investment in the banks. They need private investor in the automobile companies, et cetera. They would be crazy to get involved in anything that the United States government is involved in. They really would. And I think you'll find the checkbooks in the financial community are going to be shut tight because they can't afford to have this kind of thing done to them. But in an orderly bankruptcy, you take all the people that are owed money and you say, who has priority? Who would get this? Who would get the other? And they would be a rational process. This is not a rational process. It is a political process, and that isn't necessarily rational. Lee?
There are now more than 100 confirmed cases of the swine flu in the United States, and nearly 300 schools across the country remain closed. And until a vaccine is ready, the government has stockpiled antiviral medications that can ease flu symptoms and help prevent infection. The medicines are proving effective. There are still 300 confirmed cases in Mexico, where the flu originated, and 12 Mexicans have died from the disease, but officials say the spread of the flu there is stabilizing somewhat. The House of Representatives has passed a bill that would put an end to unfair credit card practices. It's called the Credit Card Holders Bill of Rights. It prohibits abrupt increases in interest rates and so-called double cycle billing, and it bans marketing of credit cards to people under the age of 18. Now, this bill goes to the Senate next, and if the bill passes, it will not take effect until next year. However, it will require credit card companies to give a 45-day notice before interest rates are increased, and Pat, that would take effect in 90 days.
Lee, it's all real nice, but it's being lobbied to death, and I don't think it goes far enough. People who hold credit cards are being taken advantage of in a shocking fashion. You know, if your credit score changes a little bit, you know, you miss a payment, boom, you go to 26%, that kind of thing. I mean, I don't think this bill's addressing that. And the bankers say, oh, you can't cap rates because, oh my, you won't have any credit in America. That is nonsense. They're making plenty of money. Why would they get 25, 26%? They are ripping off the American people in these credit cards. And Congress isn't doing much about it. As I say, there's so much lobbying behind the scenes. And do you want a contribution in the next election? If you do, you'd better cut that provision. That sort of thing.
Well, even banning the marketing of credit cards to kids under 18, I mean, look at the stories we've done on kids that are over 18 in college, many of whom, under the dire circumstance of the debt they've incurred, have taken their own lives out of desperation. Oh, yeah.
Well,
I mean, 18 is not enough.
Is nothing. But, you know, most parents would get a credit card and give it to their kids. So, I mean, I don't know if it really matters. But this is too little, too late. Yeah. They've really got to start doing something and get serious about it. They're not really serious. Terry?
Well, coming up, Latin America has been a breeding ground for anti-U.S. radicals. But will that change under President Obama? Find out next.
Heart attack!
Taking medication for bad cholesterol may not be enough. Focusing on bad cholesterol and not good cholesterol and triglycerides may raise your risk for a heart attack.
Any medications?
Yes, for high cholesterol.
Don't wait until it's too late to learn about the other two parts of your cholesterol. Like good cholesterol, is yours high enough? And triglycerides, too high, and they could be harmful. See if you're at risk with a free risk assessment. Call 1-888-877-9619 or visit 4heartrisk.com. It gives you important questions to ask yourself and discuss with your doctor. Because if you're not managing all of your cholesterol, along with diet, exercise, and other risk factors, you may be at increased risk for a heart attack. So bring this assessment to your doctor and learn what your cholesterol numbers are. Don't wait to get your free risk assessment, because it's your life.
Next week, discover the secret of success as told by the greatest man who ever lived. Plus, he was the big man on campus, but only in his mind.
People will have thrown up on my car. One time, someone slashed one of my tires.
How he became a hoops hero.
I went from like public enemy number one to being extremely liked on campus.
Monday on the 700 Club.
Well, over the past decade, our sitting president was occupied with a country called Iraq. And although he is a Spanish speaker, he pretty much ignored what was going on to our friends to the south. And during that period of time, Latin America has moved toward socialism rather than to free enterprise. Relations with the United States have cooled in many countries, and now countries like Iran and Russia are getting the red carpet treatment. So is a new Cold War developing in the Western Hemisphere? Dale Hurd has that answer.
Many had predicted sparks when Venezuela's President Hugo Chavez met Barack Obama for the first time. But during the summit of the Americas, the U.S. president quickly disarmed Latin leaders, pledging an agenda and a new style in relations with the Americas. And Chavez responded after apparently listening to the counsel of Brazil's president.
I said to Chavez in a speech, Chavez, I think that now you have to take the initiative to talk to President Obama. If your issues were with President Bush and not with the United States, this is the time.
At the previous summit in Argentina, Chavez led thousands in an anti-American rally. That 2005 encounter led to a wake-up call for the U.S. The Bush administration had virtually ignored Latin America while fighting the war on terror in the Middle East. And during that time, Latin America took a sharp turn to the left. The feeling in Latin America, says political commentator Carlos Montaner, is that American political and economic values have failed to deal with the needs of Latins, especially the issue of poverty.
If democracy is the type of organization that somehow sustain that type of capitalism, they don't care about democracy.
Over the last several years, a disenchanted public brought more leftist presidents to power. Two countries, Venezuela and Bolivia, became stridently anti-American, kicking out their U.S. ambassadors. The rebirth of the Latin left began ironically with the fall of the Soviet Union. Overnight, Cuba lost its biggest supporter, and Fidel Castro traveled to Sao Paulo, Brazil, where he appealed to like-minded leftists for help.
And he was trying to create a frame of friends and societies and groups and organizations and political parties that will help the dictatorship of Cuba, to survive the disappearance of the Soviet Union and the subsidies of the Soviet Union.
The Sao Paulo Forum also embraced terrorist groups, including Colombia's FARC guerrillas, major drug traffickers known for kidnappings and killings. Chavez became one of the forum's key players, using oil profits to bring more leftist leaders to power. He heads a small group that Montaner calls the Carnivorous Left, made up of Venezuela, Bolivia, Nicaragua, and Ecuador. They have established relations with some of America's worst enemies.
The relations between Venezuela, Bolivia, Nicaragua, and Ecuador with Iran could be very dangerous.
Iranians can now travel to Venezuela and Bolivia without visas. That could lead to radical Islamists joining the stream of illegals already slipping across the U.S. border. There are reports that it is already happening. Behind this Latin left resurgence, Cuba's Fidel Castro, whose prestige has grown despite his country's economic problems and his own retirement. At the summit, Latin presidents urged the U.S. to end the 47-year-old embargo against the Castro regime. So far, the U.S. has reduced travel restrictions, and the Cuban government has offered its own overtures to Washington.
The fact that you had Raul Castro say he's willing to have his government discuss with ours not just issues of lifting the embargo, but issues of human rights, political prisoners, that's a sign of progress. And so we're going to explore and see if we can make some further steps.
Raul Castro is thought to see Cuba's situation more realistically than his brother Fidel.
But he sees poor people, a very decayed society, where no one believes in communism, where the system is a completely failure. That is a big difference, and this explains why Raul Castro, when Fidel Castro is not alive anymore, will try to change things.
But even if Cuba does not change, Latin presidents want the Castro regime at future summits. They've even pledged to invite Cuba back to the Organization of American States, which expelled the Castro government 47 years ago. And that would leave the United States out of step as the only country in the hemisphere not recognizing the Castro regime. It's a sign of how the political landscape in Latin America has changed. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
I've been so much in Latin America, and the people in Latin America just love us. But I tell you, for example, in Peru, the government of Peru is conservative. They overcame an attempt by Hugo Chavez to put in a leftist. And yet, when they come up for some kind of a trade treaty with America, the American liberal labor unions rejected the treaty. The Democrats rejected because of some feigned problems about labor unions, which are, and it is feigned, it's not non-existent. Same thing with President Uribe in Colombia, who is a staunch Democrat. I mean, somebody who believes in democracy. Our Democrat-controlled government has refused to authorize a trade treaty which allowed our products to go into Colombia free of tariff. And they figure somehow this is going to help American labor unions. This is counterproductive. So we can't have little groups in our country that are sticking their fingers in the eyes of our friends. And we need to strengthen them, because Chavez is atavistic. He wants to take on as much as he can. And he certainly is trying to take power in his own country. Evo Morales in Bolivia, you know, has nationalized the gas, which is so important, and kicked out a number of oil companies down there. This is not good. We need to have friendship with our neighbors to our southern borders. We need to
have that.
And
it's amazing to see how quickly the focus and direction and bent of a government can change we're not paying attention.
Well, I mean, it's very volatile. And if these people are poor and they're arrested, they're going to, you know, revolt, and then they'll put in somebody else. But we need to do everything to strengthen them, strengthen our allies, strengthen the forces of democracy in that area. And we are not doing it. Terry?
Well, up next, a paratrooper braces for a crash landing.
Right now, we got a problem with the flaps.
The flaps control the speed of the aircraft. So if they don't work properly, the aircraft cannot slow down enough to land or for us to jump out.
How a phone call saved this flight when we come back.
The 700 Club. See it as never before. The stories, the places, the people. The 700 Club. Now in HD. We'll take you to India, China, Africa, Thailand, and across the USA. So close, you'll feel as though you were there. Look into the eyes of the people you've helped and see the hope you've given them. Experience what God is doing in the world today in high definition. The 700 Club, now in HD.
We're downtown today campaigning to save America's teeth because good dental health is about more than just brushing.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, call Encore Dental for affordable, quality dental coverage.
When was the last time you went to the dentist?
probably 3 years ago?
Probably back in college.
Poor oral health can lead to serious illnesses like heart disease and stroke.
What's your excuse?
It's just too expensive.
I'm self-employed.
No dental insurance?
None.
With Encore Dental, you can receive up to 100% coverage for preventative care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures.
George retired a year ago.
When I did, I lost my dental coverage.
There are no claim forms and no waiting for reimbursement. Call now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call 1-800-757-4903 now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call now and get an additional 10% off when you pay by credit card.
Well, we're having our annual week of prayer here at CBN, and each day our staff is gathering outside under the trees to pray for you, our partners. Yesterday, Pat gave a powerful message about why Christians should be optimistic and encouraged.
We have victory over Satan. He will be placed under our feet shortly. He is not to rule over us. He is not to bring fear against us, but he is going to be under our feet. You are a winner. He is a loser. You have won. He has lost. So get your foot on him and demonstrate who the winner is. You are a victor. And in Jesus Christ, folks, we are winners. There is no room for retreat or defeat in his programs. We are always more than conquerors through him that loved us. God gives victory to his people. He said, I have given you victory over them. And in Jesus Christ, we have victory. He said, fear not, I have overcome the world.
Well, we prayed with intention and expectancy for all of you who have sent in many of your prayer requests. It was a wonderful day. That was a great word.
It was from the Bible, and it's always a great word. Mm-hmm. But it's good to have people praying. We get together and we hold up before the Lord the prayer requests that you have sent in. And, like these, we have
tens of thousands.
We've got something like 95,000 people who've asked for prayer in various forms. These are the ones that have come in writing. In the mail, and we believe that God answers prayer. Whitney Howell didn't give it a second thought when she kissed her husband, Stephen, and sent him off to work, even though his work meant jumping out of airplanes. Little did she know that one summer afternoon, Stephen's life would hang on a wing and a prayer.
Leaping out of a plane in flight and falling thousands of feet to the ground was all in a day's work for U.S. Army paratrooper Stephen Howell.
I guess I'm just an adrenaline junkie. I just love the thrill that it gives you, when you're jumping out of an airplane going 130 miles an hour.
One afternoon, as Stephen and his air crew were preparing for a jump, something went terribly wrong.
Flaps are not tracking.
Okay, this is the pilot. This is going to be a no drop.
Right now, we've got a problem with the flaps. We've got to prepare for an emergency landing.
The flaps control the speed of the aircraft. So if they don't work properly, the aircraft cannot slow down enough to land or for us to jump out.
After you throw your packs in the middle, take your seats and put your seat belts on.
Opening a chute with the plane going too fast could cause death to the paratroopers.
And then they passed out the oxygen mask. Then when I saw the airmen strapping themselves down to the ramp, I knew something was wrong.
Stephen didn't know that at that very moment, while his life hung in the balance, his wife Whitney was talking on the phone to a CBN prayer counselor.
Hi, Dickie.
She and Stephen have been CBN partners for 13 years.
The counselor said, "Is there anything I can be praying with you about?"
"Well, my husband is jumping out of an airplane today."
I hadn't spent a lot of time in trepidation, and his job is dangerous. That just goes to show you how you can get used to anything and you can take things for granted. And she just prayed for Stephen's safety. There were no, you know, lightning flashes or thunder. It was just a sincere, brief prayer.
As Whitney and the counselor prayed, Stephen prayed as well.
I made peace with God, and I asked Him to forgive me for my sins. I asked God to protect my family and to take care of them. And I prayed for the soldiers around me, that if they didn't know Christ somehow, that they had a moment to reflect on that.
As the plane sped toward the landing field, something miraculous happened. The wing flaps began to function.
We still gotta land, but it's not an emergency landing.
I think God did it. I believe with all my heart.
Stephen and his crew landed safely. Later, he told his wife about the mechanical failure that could have turned tragic.
As he was telling me this, in my mind, I was kind of calculating, when did this happen? And it suddenly dawned on me, this is about the same time that CBN prayer counselor called me. And I just started bawling.
I was surprised as well. I didn't realize that CBN had called her and they were praying together, you know, exact moment that this was going on. So I was just, I was really overwhelmed, you know, how God was there and answered that specific prayer.
We were both really in awe of God's sovereignty. God is involved in the everyday details of people's lives. It was really an awesome time of God just pulling the curtain back a little bit for us and showing us, you know, I care about you personally.
He knew I was going to be on that operation, not just me, but 60 other soldiers. It was just a simple prayer, and God honored that by protecting us. He'll do that for anybody, because that's all He wants from us. He just wants a relationship, and prayer is the key to, you know, building that relationship. And I pray that that even just one person hears this and says, "Yeah, you know, I can trust God because He is. He's faithful. And He's trustworthy.
He's faithful. He's trustworthy." But you know, our counselor didn't know that they had that problem, but she called just at the time. You know, so many people said, "This is God's perfect time. You called." Well, they of course asked to be led by the Lord, but nevertheless, as a group of people, we want to call our partners and pray with them, and so that's what happened. By the way, Terry, I said we had 90-some thousand. We've had 125,000 prayer counts, people who are asking for prayer on the internet, on the PCC, on the direct marketing. 125,900 people have asked for prayer. That's as many as three or four times what we've ever had before. It shows a lot of people have needs. Well, we wanted to pray for you. Somebody said, "I need a financial miracle. Every month, some utility is turned off."
Oh, my.
You know, it's so those who have regular jobs and the paycheck coming in, it's hard to realize somebody that has no paycheck and they have no money and they're desperate. Terry, what do you mean?
Well, this is someone who herself has a number of physical needs that are considerable, but she's saying, "Please restore my husband's mind. He's been exhibiting extreme sudden anger, and the doctors say it may be early dementia."
Oh, heavens. That's so tragic. I mean, somebody's got to give their life to somebody that's kind of like in a vegetative state. "Renewed strength and total healing for my husband after a total knee replacement." Well, I had a half one of those, and it wasn't too bad. I was riding a horse in a week after that, so hopefully the Lord touches you as well.
Get a horse.
Get a horse, and you'll be healthy. Colon cancer needs special prayer. "God will restore and heal my wife's mind." Now, that's the second. You've got a problem with one, problem with the other. All right,
whatever. This is a woman saying, "Please pray for my husband to be delivered from adultery and for my marriage to be restored." Someone else saying, "After many unsuccessful surgeries, I need healing of a hip condition." And someone else asking for healing of blurred vision and a chronic lung infection. So lots of needs out there.
Folks, this group, if you give me a camera, they've grown. This pile has grown and grown and grown all week long. Mm-hmm. As thousands and thousands. Now it's 125,000 people have asked for prayer. We want to pray for you, your need. Terry and I are going to join together. And folks, nothing is impossible. God wants to do something wonderful for you today. This is the day of the Lord's visitation in your life. So don't go anywhere. Right now, I want you to join with us. What is your need? What is your problem? You may not even know you had one. Whitney Howell didn't have any idea that Stephen's life was in danger. She didn't know that. The morning began. You never know. Yeah. Father, in Jesus' name, we are humbled with the number of people who are crying out to God. We think of people who've lost jobs. They think of people whose homes are in foreclosure. We think of people whose marriages are on the rocks and are fighting each other. We think of people who are desperately ill and just had automobile accidents and they're in the hospital and trauma units. We think of people, oh God, who are crying out to you, please help me. Now, right now, Lord, we join with them and we say, in the name of Jesus, be made whole. And may the Lord touch you and meet your need, touch your mind and your spirit and your body. Terry?
Well, first of all, I think the Lord is saying to so many of you, I am here. I hear you. I see you. Call upon me. Give me the opportunity to speak into your need. And then there's somebody, you have a condition with your eardrum. You've had some kind of damage there for some reason, and God is restoring your hearing to you. Just place your hand over your ear and receive what God is doing in your inner ear right now.
This blurry vision, you just said, God, help me. And put your hands over your eyes right now. In the name of Jesus, your eyes will focus. You shall see properly in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Father. A neck and spine injury. You've had a neck injury. Mm-hmm. It's not a whiplash, but it's some kind of a neck injury. And the Lord has healed you right now. Right as I'm speaking, you'll be able to move and any paralysis will go away. Terry, what else you have?
Someone else, you've been having tingling in your extremities, your feet, your calves, your hands, and you have not seen a doctor, but you've been very concerned about it. God is healing that condition for you right now. You'll not have it again.
The Lord says, trust in me. Yes. Trust in me. Trust in me. Trust in me. Trust in God. Nothing's impossible with Him. Trust in Him. Father, for those that are having difficult financial problems, and there are many of them, we ask, Lord, that you might reach down and touch their finances. Lord, may there be a multiplication of the finances they need in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, continue to bless us. May your spirit move in the hearts of everyone in this audience. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And amen. Terry.
Well, up next, being chased and feeling like you can't get away is a common nightmare. But for one gangster, it wasn't just a bad dream.
I could see them coming, and so I begin to run through the parking lot. At this point, I'm trying to climb the fence, but I can't get up.
Find out if he escaped next.
Every year, thousands of Americans will fall in their homes. Every year, thousands of house fires will start while its occupants are away. Now, protect yourself and your home with Alert USA. For just pennies a day, you'll get an advanced personal alarm system that, with the push of a button, connects you to our emergency response center. Act now and get a quality smoke detector that connects to our monitoring station. So, with Alert USA, you're protected when you're home, and your home is protected when you're not home. For a free brochure, call now.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. A trial is underway in Paris for 27 people charged in the torture and murder of Ilan Halimi. Halimi's murder 3 years ago has become a symbol of growing anti-Semitism in France. It's believed Halimi was targeted because he was Jewish. When chief suspect Youssef Fofana took his seat in court Wednesday, he shouted that Allah will be victorious. Fofana and the other suspects allegedly held the 23-year-old Halimi captive for 3 weeks. They phoned his family while torturing him, demanding money, and reading verses from the Quran before killing him. CBN's Operation Blessing has formed a partnership with the Mayo Clinic. The two organizations teamed up recently to conduct medical clinics in El Salvador. 8 Mayo Clinic doctors and 12 students treated more than 1,000 patients during this mission. They distributed vitamins, antiparasitics, cough syrup, and pain relievers, and more of these missions are planned. If you would like to know more about Operation Blessing and what they're doing around the world and in the United States and how you can get involved, please go to our website at ob.org. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club after this.
Pat Boone here from my good friends at Swiss America, the company that's helped Americans to rediscover gold for over 25 years now. You may have noticed gold prices have more than doubled in the last 5 years, but do you ever wonder why? Economists say the top five reasons are a falling dollar, which also creates number two, a rising cost of living. Third, increasing demand for gold worldwide. Fourth, political uncertainty. And fifth, new Wall Street gold funds. It all adds up to higher prices ahead. Gold offers safety first and then profit. A wise economist has said, a portfolio without gold is like walking around naked in 0-degree temperatures. So don't get caught in the cold without gold. Call Swiss America now for a free educational kit. Ask about tax-free gold IRAs. Seize this rare opportunity today. Call now.
Next week, discover the secret of success as told by the greatest man who ever lived. Plus, he was the big man on campus, but only in his mind.
People will have thrown up on my car. One time, someone slashed one of my tires.
How he became a hoops hero.
I went from like public enemy number one to being extremely liked on campus.
Monday on the 700 Club.
The term to earn your stripes means you've done something worthy of a position. In gang culture, it means you're tough enough to be a member. Jack Hakimian wanted to prove his worth, and so did many other teens that lived in his neighborhood. Jack didn't know that when they went to earn their gang stripes, that it would come at his expense.
The gun was too powerful or strong, and when he shot it, it cocked back on him, and I hit the ground, and I saw, you know, I touched myself to see if I had been shot, and I had.
Violence was a way of life for Jack Hakimian. He grew up in the tough neighborhoods of Los Angeles, where his role models were gang members.
He pulled out that gun and began to cap on these enemies, these Crips, and I realized, okay, if you want respect, if you want power, if you want influence on a high school street level, then you gotta put in your work.
Jack joined the infamous LA Bloods, but he quickly found out the streets never delivered what they promised.
I'd been arrested twice for selling cocaine. I had been almost killed several times. I'd been betrayed by other Bloods.
The more Jack got involved in the gang, the more he learned the rhythm of the streets.
The more violence you do, the more things you steal, the more money you make, the more stripes you get. So for me, I was just trying to get more stripes, to get more recognition.
And danger was never too far behind. Jack remembers the day he and a friend were confronted by rival gang members.
You could see their frenzy, like almost they're out the window with sawed-off shotguns and guns, like ready to kill me. And I could see them coming, and so I begin to run through the parking lot. And they're literally chasing me, but of course they're about 50 yards away from me. At this point, I'm trying to climb the fence, but I can't get up. I felt their hands on my back. I heard them say, "Come here, you slob." All I hear is, "We're gonna kill you, you slob." And then I black out. 3-4 hours later, I wake up. I'm in a paramedic.
Still, Jack remained loyal to the Bloods. It was only when he started seeing his friends die that he realized he had to change.
And I remember being alone in the room and praying without even knowing I was praying, that maybe God would help me and protect me. And that's part of why I got this cross on my fist, as you can see, because I always saw this religious symbol of the cross as one of protection.
One day, Jack was pulled over for tailgating and arrested. He was sentenced to 6 months for violating his parole.
It was just that reality that here I am in the Blood module with these men who literally look like Satan embodied in the flesh, because you could see them calculating. What are they gonna take from you? They're gonna take your money, they're gonna take your body, they're gonna take your dignity so they can have more stripes. And I remember looking up in that concrete room ceiling and just beginning to cry. And I said, God, if you're real, Jesus, if you're real, I don't know who you are, Jesus, I just knew to say Jesus, you know. If you're real, help me. Please help me.
2 hours later, Jack was transferred to another unit. A pastor gave him a Bible, which he began to read.
I'm telling you, the Word of God was just jumping out and speaking to me. Jesus showed up and began to help me. And one of the first things that he did was he began to pour out his peace into my heart, into my life. And this peace started from the inside.
Over the next 6 months, Jack made a sincere commitment to turn his life around.
God confronted me, and I just broke down. I began to cry, and I began to weep. And I just made that commitment to Jesus that, man, Lord, I need to walk with you.
But when Jack was released from jail, he started hanging out with the gang again. Then one day, he had to make a choice to stand for God when the gang leader told his followers to kill their rivals.
This fire came into my heart because I realized what he was saying, and it was basically destructive. I said, you know, God would not be happy. He said, well, I'm gonna show you who God is. And he went into the other room and he got his 12-gauge sawed-off shotgun and came back outside and to the living room, and I just reached out my hands to him. And I said, you know, I'm just giving this advice because I don't want them to go to hell. I don't want them to spend life in prison. I don't want people to die unnecessarily. At that point, he just said, look, man, I want you to leave right now. And I took his offer real quick.
Jack left the gang for good that day and never looked back. Today, he's married with 4 sons and owns his own computer web design company.
God has redeemed my life, I would say, in a holistic way. It's not just, you know, forgiveness, it's not just peace, but it's a beautiful wife, a beautiful 4 boys.
Jack knows he's now fighting a different battle, one that he's willing to lay down his life for, one with eternal significance.
He will give you a new set of friends. He'll give you a whole new set of codes to live by. And those codes won't lead you to death and misery and pain, but it'll lead to joy, peace, and of course, eternal life.
Why, Jack's life is such a picture of life for us. You know, every one of us is searching for identity. Who are we? What are we about? Why are we here? Sometimes we're in need of love, if that's been missing from our lives. Attention, success, it can be all kinds of things that we're striving for. You know, the things that really, really matter, that really speak to our hearts, happen inside of us. It's not something that you can just wander around and pick up from other people or make a random decision and suddenly find contentment and fulfillment. And yet, God created us and intended for us to have those things. When I look at Jack's life, one of the big things I see is how much our choices have consequences. But the great thing is we have the choice. We can choose what direction we're going in, who we're going to hang with, whether we're going to stay married or not, whether we're going to hit that button on the computer that's going to take us to a porn site, whether we're going to take another hit of something that we know is just going to take hold of our lives and control us and spin us off into a direction that's going to ruin everything. Listen, the choice is ours. So how do you handle that when temptation is strong in your life? Do what Jack did. Go to the one who has the power to take the temptation away. Go to the one who has the power to give you identity and purpose, the one who created you to have a life that matters and has meaning. Right now, in this moment, consider the very thing that you've been doing that could change the course of your life forever. Ask God to help you, to give you the purpose and the identity in your life that you've been longing for, to repair whatever's been broken in your life and your relationships. You can have all of that right now. He says, ask me. I stand at the door of your heart and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in. That's what he says. Doesn't say if the person is this race or if the person makes this much money, if the person's had a good background. Anybody who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So what are you going to do today? What are you going to do? faced with the same kind of choices, maybe different circumstances that Jack was faced with, what are you going to do? Will you invite Christ into the middle of your life today? Into the middle of your circumstances. Take it. It's yours. Pray with me right now. Pray. Let's go. Let's do it. Lord, I want to know who I am. I want to know who you are. I want to know why I'm here. And you know, God, that I need to make a turnaround in the choices I'm making. I know that the things I'm choosing to do could be harmful. There's something in me that drives me to do the things I don't want to do. And so today I'm coming to you and I'm just saying, take me. Don't just take my circumstances, take me. I'm giving you everything that I am and all that I have in Jesus. Be the Savior of my soul. I need you. I want you. I'm asking you also to be the Lord of my life. I want to learn how to think differently, how to live differently. I want to overcome the temptation in my life. I want to be what you created me to be. So will you come into the middle of my heart? Forgive me. I am so sorry for the things I've done that have gone against you. And then change me. I give you my mind, give you my heart. Help me to hear your voice when you speak to me, to see the world around me the way that you see it. And give me the power, give me your Holy Spirit, the strength within me to make wise, right choices in my life so that I can live for you and live the way you created me to. Thank you for hearing my prayer today. Thank you for waiting for me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for your mercy and your grace extended to me when I've been living so far away from you. I receive it all today, and I give all that I have back to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you've prayed that prayer, then you are on the journey of a lifetime. God is good, and He loves you. We'd like to tell you how you can grow in your knowledge of Him. Pat's put together a little packet for you called A Higher Calling. You can have it for free if you'll call 1-800-759-0700. Tell somebody what you did on the other end of the line. I just prayed that prayer. I'd like the free information. You can also get this by logging on to cbn.com. But get close to God. Find out who He is and who you are in Him. Pat?
Thanks, Terry. Many people are calling, and keep in mind that even though the lines are busy, we've got people here all day long. So pick up the phone, call in. 24 hours, we're here for you. Well, we've got email like this one from Eva, who says, I usually dress casually when I go to church, but people give me a hard time about what I wear. Does God care about how we dress? Stay tuned. We'll bring it on.
Songs that speak to our hearts and bring us hope. Time Life presents I Can Only Imagine, the greatest power anthems of the Christian faith.
I can only imagine.
And now, the I Can Only Imagine collection is bigger and better than ever. Presenting I Can Only Imagine Platinum. 22 songs on 2 CDs.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Plus, you'll also get an exclusive bonus CD, including this special version of I Can Only Imagine.
Surrounded by your glory, one will my heart feel.
Call now to get I Can Only Imagine Platinum. Now on 3 CDs for just
$19.99.
Wait, call in the next 10 minutes with your credit card, and we'll cut the price to just
$9.99. God is in control.
That's 3 CDs, 30 powerful Christian anthems for just
$9.99.
Then review other inspirational collections, satisfaction guaranteed. Call now and get I Can Only Imagine Platinum on 3 CDs for just $9.99.
In Christ alone.
Call 1-800-818-7713 to order I Can Only Imagine Platinum for $9.99 plus shipping. Call in the next 10 minutes with your credit card and get a bonus CD. Or order online at timelife.com/I Can Only Imagine.
I want to take the time we have left in this program to answer some of your email questions. Pat, this first one is from Eva, who says, Pat, I usually dress casually when I go to church, but it's nothing inappropriate. The problem is people are always giving me a hard time about what I wear. Does God care how we dress for church? Can't I just come as I am?
Well, Eva, let me tell you, if you were going to have an audience with the Queen of England, would you show up at Buckingham Palace with a halter top and a cut-off jeans and flip-flops?
Yeah.
The answer is no way. You dress up, boy, you're going to meet with the Queen. Same thing if you go into the White House, you're going to meet with the President. You wouldn't go in sort of casual, but yet we think we can go before God with just all this slovenly stuff. I see these kids, I mean, it's just disgusting. I don't think God is all hung up on clothes. But I do think it's important to show respect. You're in the house of the Lord, and there needs to be a certain amount of reverence. We're in God's house. Mm-hmm. And in the old days, he dealt very harshly with those who took advantage of it. But your question is, does God care whether you're all dressed up or not? And the answer is absolutely not, because the worst thing you could do is to spend all your time flossing yourself up all pretty. Mm-hmm. And so you want people to look at you instead of the Lord. You want to, the Bible says, let the women be dressed modestly. All right.
This is Corrine, who says, Pat, I've been living with my boyfriend for years now, and we're still not married. He doesn't want to marry me because of his previous bad marriage. There's a part of me that still desires marriage. What can I do?
Walk out. The sooner the better. You're doing something that's wrong, and he's playing you for a fool. He's had a, quote, previous bad marriage. Well, tough luck. I mean, you can't do that. The trouble with women, they don't realize that men are interested in having physical relations. And if they give them the physical relations with no obligation, then they'll take them gladly. And then they'll walk out on them when there's any obligation put upon them. You know, it's a partnership. And if a man doesn't want to marry you, then don't live with him, all right?
This is Luz, who says, I've made 20 years of mistakes and bad choices, even though I went to church. I slept around with different men and hurt people that were close to me. I feel like it's too late for God to help me. Is there still hope for me after so many years of poor judgment?
Luz, there's always hope. There's always hope in God. He loves you, and he wants to forgive you. And what he's concerned about is that you would be cleansed from dead works to serve the living God. That's what the Bible says. Get all that stuff behind you, and the minute you come to the Lord, he'll take care of it. You don't, the past, you leave it behind. What else?
Well, this next one's a long one, so I don't think we have time
for
it. Well, okay. My parents divorced 10 years ago. My dad stole $4,000 from me several years ago, so I haven't talked with him in 2 years. Basically, his relationship with family is non-existent. I plan to talk with him soon because I think he's giving up on life.
I think you've got to go to him, tell him you want him as a father, you need a father, and you honor him as a father. And even though he's done terrible things, you tell him you forgive him, and you love him unconditionally. But that you want to be a father, you want him to be your father, and you want to be his son. And tell him you love him. And if he doesn't respond to it, just keep praying for him. But that will soften his heart, and that's all you can do. And I don't think I'd do anything else. A confrontation is not the answer. We leave you today with these words from Hebrews 13:5. Be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Well, that's all the time we've got. Have a great weekend, and we'll be talking to you again on Mondays. Until then, goodbye.